the historical roots of the rapidly expanding cult of Mary with the worship of ancient goddesses and other pagan practices have been examined in an earlier chapter. Such links now seem to strengthen what we assumed before, or even proved before. The New Age movement is undoubtedly advancing on many fronts, not least in the church, which will not endure sound doctrine having itching ears. Many Christians have drunk deep draughts of New Age potions. For example, holistic health, hypnosis, yoga, inner healing, meditation, psychical research and awareness training, and many have imbibed new doctrines and heresies based on the humanistic and positive thinking of Teilhard de Chardin, Norman Vincent Peale and others, which provide the Church with its emphasis on an earthly kingdom now, the social gospel and society reconstructed for Christianized with kingdom principles for the Lord's return. Restorationist leader Bryn Jones, writing in the beginning of 1991, promised his followers that, quote, "By the power of his Spirit, we will bring all that is against God and man beneath Christ's authority. God's Church will be the most influential body of people on earth in the final period of this age." Unquote. This is indeed a prophetic word, but it is fulfilled in Scripture only by the apostate church of the Book of Revelation. Hello and welcome everybody to a new video from Juggler 66, Hour of the Truth. This one's called Multi-Faith and the New Age and deals with Chapter 8 of the book I'm currently reading, All Roads Lead to Rome, by Michael de Semlyen. I've come here to the computer to read this book to you on the 24th of September, a very beautiful Sabbath day, no cloud on the sky, more than 20 degrees centigrade, 23, 24, really nice weather, even though the fall has already started. And still I'm a little bit in the summer mood, and I'm getting really in the mood of reading this book and reading it quickly because it is so fascinating to read this book. Today I read first chapter 8 in German, now comes the English version. I should have probably done it the other way around because I saw that on page 100 there is a footnote in the English version that is missing in the German version. And of course I couldn't make a remark on that in the German reading because I did that first. Anyway, we have seen already 7 chapters and the last chapter was called, as you probably know, Towards Unity. And we are now going to read Chapter 8, as the video is called, as I told you, Multi-Faith and the New Age. Multi-Faith, yeah, what's that all about? Nothing biblical, eh? There's only one faith, there's one true faith, there's one true gospel, and that is that of Jesus Christ of the Bible. Anyway, gonna start reading. Meanwhile, ecclesiastical Meanwhile, ecclesiastically, the Pope reigns supreme. On the world stage, successive archbishops of Canterbury have deferred naturally to him. Illustrative was of this was the Daily Telegraph headline, "A Pipe of Peace at Pope's Prayer Day," referring to the 27th of October 1986, Assisi World Day of Prayer, when the warring factions of Nicaragua, El Salvador and elsewhere laid down their arms. Involved amongst others by Archbishop Runcie, the Dalai Lama, Hindus, Sikhs, Muslims, Baha'is, Shintoists and pagan cult leaders, even including snake worshippers from Togo. What do all these people have to do with the body of Christ? I mean, even when you are a Catholic and you call yourself the body of Christ, the one true God, How can you have a meeting, an ecclesiastical meeting, with the Dalai Lama, who is also referred to as Holiness, with Hindus, with Sikhs, with Muslims, Baha'is, Shintoists, pagan cult leaders, and snake worshippers from Togo? Do you have no idea what the snake, the serpent, represents? How can there be a unity between the body of Christ and snake worshippers, I ask you? Although the Roman Catholic Church is not officially one of the 317 member churches of the World Council of Churches, about 25% of WCC staff are Roman Catholics. Yes, the Roman Catholic Church is not officially one of the 317 member churches of the World Council of Churches. That's true, because the idea of the World Council of Churches is to get all the different religions in the world together to argue and to agree on a compromise eventually, that compromise will bring them back under the Church of Rome, who is not a member of the World Council of Churches, but is the so-called quote-unquote Mother Church, waiting outside of the realm of the World Council of Churches until everybody in this council agrees in that way that their traditions now fit the traditions of the Roman Catholic Church. When they are all in one agreement to go back under the wings of Rome, there is your one world religion. And of course, Bible-believing Christians are not invited, because first of all, we do not compromise, and second of all, we have the real gospel, the gospel of the Jesus Christ of the Bible, of the God, the Creator, the God, Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that differentiates us from all the other so-called religions in the world. Rome's leadership of both the peace movement, the author continues, and the multi-faith advance towards religious unity parallels her central role in the quest for political unity. Now, wait, did I read that right? Listen to it again. Rome's leadership of both the peace movement and the multi-faith advance towards religious unity parallels her central role in the quest for political unity. So we are talking about the Roman Catholic Church, right? And we are speaking here about political unity? Anybody who up to now did not understand that the Roman Catholic Church is nothing else but the pagan political Roman Empire that hid itself under the veil of Christianity has to understand that now. Rome is first and for all a political power. And that political power is hidden under so-called quote-unquote Christianity, which is not Christianity at all, but Babylonian paganism. It says here right so, and this is something that I have said through the years. It is something that Tom Fress has said all the years in all his readings. Rome is first and for all a political power. And otherwise, if you do not believe that, go to the Discorsi of Pope Pius IX, where he says, "The Caesar that now addresses you, and to whom alone obedience is due." Yeah? Look it up in the Discorsi of Pope Pius IX. The Caesar, he says, the Pontifex Maximus, the old Pergamum title of a man deified. That is what the Pope represents. Multi-faith religion can now readily be seen as closely associated with the Church of Rome through the many initiatives taken by the Vatican. Assisi was the venue which readily commanded itself to the Worldwide Fund for Nature's president, the Duke of Edinburgh, to stage that organization's 25th anniversary special event. The shrine of St. Francis, the increasingly important patron of saint of animals and their conservation, played a significant role in that event. In fact, two separate events, the meeting of religious leaders and the WWF anniversary, took place consecutively, so that many people had the opportunity to attend and influence both. Following on from that trailblazing initiative of combining world faith, there has been a succession of interfaith festivals and services organized in Britain's leading cathedrals by New Ager Martin Palmer and others. The first at Winchester in 1987, which was a creation harvest festival, launching the Rainbow Covenant between man and nature, was followed by conferences and festivals linking faith and ecology at Coventry, Birmingham, Canterbury and Salisbury cathedrals. Now, let me just stop here for a second. I just read to you, launching the Rainbow Covenant between man and nature. I call that blasphemy and turning around the Word of God. Because after the flood, God made a covenant with mankind, Noah and his family, and told them that the rainbow that will appear in the sky is a sign, a contract between God and mankind that he will never ever again flood the earth as he did before, when he wiped out all living creatures on earth except for the family of Noah that was saved in the ark that God commanded Noah to build. Every living creature that survived was on that ark. And the rainbow was his covenant with mankind for that event. And this rainbow is misused, abused now as a in part of this creation harvest festival, as a sign between man and nature. No, it was a sign between man and God, and not between man and the creation, but between man and the Creator. There is the big difference. And just think back a few months in the United States of America, where after the Supreme Court ruled same-sex marriages are legal, they put the White House in rainbow colors. Why do you think this LGBT movement all over the world has the rainbow as its sign? It is because they are mocking God. The Canterbury gathering in September 1989, continues the author, enabled three separate pilgrimages to converge at the site where King Henry II submitted to the Pope. After this, the combined procession led by the Archbishop of York, a leading ecumenist, made its way to pray at Thomas a Becket shrine inside the cathedral. Thus it was that at Canterbury in September 1989, at this conference on Christian faith and ecology, interfaith and ecumenical religion were seen and experienced together as one. Now, if you are not familiar with the history of King Henry II of England and Thomas a Becket, who was part of that also, a Roman Catholic, of course, then I really urge you to do your studies on that, because it is a wonderful story about a rebelling king against the Pope who did not give all the taxes that the Pope asked to him, and therefore he was punished in Canterbury. I've learned from that from my brother in Christ, Robert Newman, and it was very interesting to learn about that story. So you can look that up. Henry II, Thomas Becket, and the Pope. Anyway, continuing now on page 92. Green issues, so important now politically, have been important to the Vatican from before the beginnings of ecological concerns in the 1960s, and have been linked to the Roman Church's leadership of the wider peace movement. The theme for the World Day of Peace in 1990 was peace with God the Creator, peace with all of creation. Yeah. Peace with God the Creator. If you want to have peace with God the Creator, just follow His rules. Follow His commandments. Follow what He says. And don't do what you think yourself is best. Do as thou wilt, as is today in the people the most followed doctrine. Peace with all of creation? Well, when you are in peace with the Father, the Creator God in heaven, you're automatically in peace with all of creation. The Vatican statement announcing the Day of Peace spoke of ecological problems reflecting a moral crisis in understanding the relationship between human beings and the environment. Yeah, today we have the so-called global warming. There is no problem between quote-unquote human beings and quote-unquote nature or the environment. There is only the wrath of God that is, of course, telling us that we have been wrongdoing, and therefore He punishes His creation for not adhering to Him. The five world faith that signed the declarations at Assisi had become seven when they addressed both houses of parliament in 1988. As at Assisi, a Franciscan, this time a friar, spoke for Christianity. In May 1989, at the United Nations building in New York, the Duke of Edinburgh launched the International Sacred Literature Trust, which he believes, quote, will make a significant contribution to interfaith dialogue, unquote. So throw it all together. Ecumenism, theological dogma, political and environmental goals. Mix it all up. International Sacred Literature Trust, which he believes will make a significant contribution to interfaith dialogue. Okay. A comment from Dave Hunt, evangelical commentator and author of The Seduction of Christianity, helps us to see a clearer picture. Dave Hunt, by the way, also wrote this fantastic book, A Woman Rides the Beast. I can only advise you to go and look that up and read that book. Even though that Dave Hunt wrote that book, A Woman Rides the Beast, even until his death, he did not see, he did not accept the Pope, the papacy, as the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist. He was, even though that he wrote this wonderful book, betrayed in a certain way. But let's read from his quote from the book, The Seduction of Christianity. The current Pope is the leader of worldwide ecumenism. As such, he presents an altogether different picture from the inflexible dogmatist determined to convert the world to Catholicism that most people imagine a Pope to personify. On the contrary, John Paul II has taken the initiative in contacting leaders of the world's religions, accepts them as working towards the same goals of social justice, ecological wholeness and world peace, suggests that their prayers are as effective as those of Catholics, and has not attempted to convert any of them. He seems content to be acknowledged as the spiritual leader of the world's religions uniting for peace. So what did I just say about a few minutes ago? Now the Pope's, Dave Hunt writes here, he seems content, the Pope, seems to be content to be acknowledged as the spiritual leader of the world's religions uniting for peace. Yeah, So in the World Council of Churches they come all together, and then he will be the leader of the then new formed One World Religion. Yet at the time the same Pope continues to claim that the Roman Church is the Bride of Christ, the one true Church devoted to one person, the Son of the Living God. What is described in this section is not the behavior of a bride, chaste and pure. It is the behavior of an harlot, readily recognizable as the great whore of Revelation 17. Christians were encouraged by the appointment of a declared evangelical at the See of Canterbury, and one who at his enthronement appeared to be affirming the unique standing of the Christian gospel among world religions. Addressing leaders of other faiths assembled in Canterbury Cathedral, George Carey said, quote, "The faith that I have in Christ and in his good news is so important that I am compelled. Necessity is laid upon me to share it with all people. But I trust that I can listen to your story and respect your integrity, even though I may still want to offer you, as to all, the claims of my Lord." Unquote. However, in office, George Carey has adopted a totally different position. He has taken issue with the 2,000 evangelical clergymen who petitioned Her Majesty the Queen's protest over the Commonwealth's interfaith service at Westminster Abbey. Speaking in September 1992 at a session of the Conference of European Churches in Prague, he said, quote, "We dare not allow our peoples to return to historic rivalries. In this context, not only ecumenism, but also interfaith cooperation is paramount." Unquote. Long regarded by conservative evangelicals as wobbly, the Archbishop is already appearing to seek to be all things to all men. Exactly what the Pope is, right? Certainly his support of the Evangelical Catholic Alliance in Northern Ireland, which aims to prove it possible to be both evangelical and Roman Catholic at the same time, bears this out. So the next part in this chapter is called The New Age. Vatican II's Nostra Aetate included this statement, quote, "Different religions have tried to respond to mankind's search for the ultimate explanation of creation and the meaning of man's journey through life. The Catholic Church accepts the truth and goodness found in these religions, and she sees reflections there of the truth of Christ, whom she proclaims as the way, the truth, and the life. She wishes to do everything possible to cooperate with other believers in preserving all that is good in their religions and cultures." Unquote. Meaning, to compromise, but never forget, not the Roman Church is compromising, the other ones have to compromise. And when the Roman Catholic Church says that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, don't forget they are talking of another Jesus. They are spreading another gospel. The omnipresent New Age movement, which came into the open in 1975, is also helping to bring the world religions together, especially through Western adoption of aspects of Hindu and Buddhist thought and practice. The Roman Catholic Church has done much to contribute to this in advancing its strategy for ecumenical and religious cooperation. For example, in the entire May-June edition of The Catholic World in 1990 was given over to Buddhism. Among the articles included in that edition were "The Buddha Revered as a Christian Saint" and a glowing biography of, quote, "His Holiness, the Dalai Lama." Unquote. That is blasphemy. The Dalai Lama is no holiness, as is the Pope no holiness. The Tibetan Buddhist was described as having frequent contact with Catholic leaders, including his quote-unquote old friend, John Paul II, whom he has met at least 5 times, and Paul VI, with whom he had 2 meetings. The present Pope has endorsed him as a great spiritual leader. Like Mother Teresa and Lech Walesa, the Polish leader of Solidarność movement, the Dalai Lama is also a Nobel Prize winner. Yeah, look at all the Nobel Prize winners. They are all doing, fighting only for the Roman Catholic Church. At his initiation ceremony, he was named, quote, the Holy One, the tender glory, mighty in speech, of excellent intellect, of absolute wisdom, holding the doctrine, the ocean. Unquote. From the Chambers Encyclopedia, volume 13, page 621, referring to the Dalai Lama. It is instructive, as we consider these things, to remember that at the first Parliament of the World Religions Conference at Chicago in 1892, the objective stated by widely acclaimed Eastern mystic Swami Vivekananda was to be, quote, a society compounded of Western science, socialism, and Indian spirituality, unquote. The second Parliament of World Religions, which took place in 1992, so 100 years after the first meeting, at the Temple of Understanding, the Spiritual United Nations in Washington, D.C., was able to celebrate the near fulfillment of Vivekananda's prophecy. In 1981, the Pope spoke of the special place Rome accords to Western religions. Quote, ways must be discovered, he said, to make the dialogue with all religions become a reality everywhere, but especially in Asia, the cradle of ancient cultures and religions. Unquote. Just 9 years later, he predicted that a new injection of life for the Church in the next few years would come from the East. Just as worshippers do in Roman Catholic ritual, the Pope is looking towards the East. Flying over Moscow, something permitted to the papacy for the first time in more than 85 years, on his way to Seoul, the Pope is said to have exclaimed, quote, Lux ex oriente. There will be a new religious life in Europe from the East. Unquote. In Ezekiel, we can read that 25 men were in the temple of God, turning away to the east, worshipping the sun. What is that new light that comes from the east? From the light bearer? From Lucifer? From Satan? That has nothing to do with anything written ever in the Bible. Ecumenism, Mysticism, and the New Age, the book continues. Annie Besant, pioneer theosophist, in her book Mysticism, wrote, and before I read the quote, if you do not know who Annie Besant was, he was of the Theosophical Society that was founded by Petrova Helena Blavatsky and also followed up by Alice Bailey, who founded Lucifer's Trust, that was then later changed into Lucis Trust, a still today, 2016, official publishing company for publishing papers for the United Nations under the name of Lucis Trust. So she wrote, Annie Besant, in her book Mysticism, quote, The Roman Catholic has always kept a knowledge of that path and method by which the supreme knowledge may be gained. He calls the end of it by a startling name. Generally, the word union is used, but take up some great book of Roman Catholic theology and you will find the startling word which I have in mind. They call it deification. The deification of man. Man become God, for nothing less than that is meant by deification. And the Hindu and the Buddhist call it liberation, the setting free of the human spirit from the bonds which have tied him down, from the metta which has blinded him. The meaning is the same, the method is the same, the thing is the same. And so we realize that in the realm of the spirit there are none of those divisions that mark off one religion from another in the separative plane of earth. And we realize that the spirit is united where earth holds diversity. And that where knowledge takes the place of faith, the controversy sinks into silence and the certainty of truth is known. Unquote. Where should I even start to make a comment here on that little quote from Annie Besant? The deification of man, man become God, that is the lie established by the serpent in the Garden of Eden. Turning Eve to eat from the fruit of the forbidden tree of knowledge. Yea, has God said, you will not surely die. When you eat of the fruit, you will be as gods. Deification of man, man become God. The same lie over and over again. And then it says that the spirit united where earth holds diversity and that where knowledge takes the place of faith. What knowledge? Not the knowledge of the Bible, because the knowledge of the Bible can never do away with faith. That's the point. We all have to have faith. Through faith we are saved. Not through knowledge, and certainly not through worldly knowledge, through worldly wisdom, but only by the wisdom that is imputed to us when we read the Bible and the Holy Spirit leads us. Now there's much in Roman Catholic tradition to contribute to New Age thinking. Mysticism, medieval and modern, the writings and activities of prominent Catholics past and present, such as Teilhard de Chardin, Thomas Merton, Matthew Fox, and Mother Teresa. The output of educational institutions such as the Jesuit Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., including that of leading conspiracy theorist Georgetown professor Carol Quigley, who, by the way, was the mentor of Bill Clinton. Teilhard de Chardin, also a Jesuit professor, sowed many seeds for the New Age movement, especially in relation to man's control over the evolutionary process. There is no evolutionary process, but of course the Pope accepts evolution and says that it goes hand in hand with the creation story of the Bible. So-called Father Thomas Merton championed the merger of Zen Buddhism and Christianity. American Dominican Matthew Fox's creation-centered spirituality, based on multi-faith and pagan ideas, is bringing deep ecumenism and deep ecology together within the New Age. Mother Teresa has made a major contribution to the new universal religion. In 1981 at St. James Church in Piccadilly, London, which through its rector, Donald Reeves, has a growing relationship with New Age Centre Findhorn in Inverness Shire, Mother Teresa gave the first public pronouncement of Satish Kumar's Hindu Universal Prayer for Peace, now widely used by ecumenical churches. Mother Teresa has been an honorary guest at intercultural interfaith gatherings in Malta and in Oxford. Oxford, by the way, is the cradle of Roman Catholicism going back to England with the Oxford movement of the 1830s. The Malta Conference in March 1985, organized to celebrate 40 years of United Nations, brought together representatives of religious groupings including shamanism, Kabbalism, occultism, the peace movement, and the ecumenical movement. Among those attending were New Age leaders including author Marilyn Ferguson and UN Assistant Secretary General Robert Mueller, as well as the Dalai Lama. The Dalai Lama himself presides over a religion which incorporates strands of Mahayana Buddhism mixed with the mystical formularies, magic and occult of the Trans-Trayana and the Tibetan shamanism, which is also based on magic and sorcery, as we can read from Alan Morrison in The Trojan Horse in the Temple from September-October 1989. What does magic and the occult have to do, and sorcery have to do, with the true word of the living God? He condemns all those things in the Bible. No sorcerer, no soothsayer, no shamanist, no sorcerer, no witch will ever enter through the gates of heaven. We come to ecumenism and the New Age. The ecumenical link with the New Age movement is very apparent. In her book, The Findhorn Community, Carol Riddle, resident at Findhorn, sociologist and devotee of Indian yogi Sai Baba, states that, quote, Sufism, transcendental meditation, and the entire Christian ecumenical movement, exemplified by the Taiz community, are our brothers and sisters in the network of light. Unquote. Quote, Part of the Aquarian Age is the rediscovery of feminine goddess energy as opposed to the patriarchal, aggressively male energy of the last 2,000 years, unquote, claimed one of many positive feature articles about the New Age now appearing in the press. We can read that in the Sunday Telegraph from the 28th of April, 1991. Time magazine reported in May 1991 that Mother Earth worship services are part of a growing United States spiritual movement. Goddess worship, the effort to create a female-centered focus for spiritual expression. Adherents claim that the movement involves as many as 100,000 United States women. Through such ancient goddesses as Isis and Astarte are often, though such ancient goddesses as Isis and Astarte are often invoked, most worship occurs in the name of a vague generic goddess, often depicted as Mother Earth or Gaia, in line with environmental awareness. Unquote, as we can read in Time magazine, May 6, 1991. So this whole earth worships thing, this whole nature worship thing, this whole Gaia movement is actually nothing else but referring to the Queen of Heaven in disguise. I hope you get that. The historical roots of the rapidly expanding cult of Mary with the worship of ancient goddesses and other pagan practices have been examined in an earlier chapter. Such links now seem to strengthen what we assumed before, or even proved before. The New Age movement is undoubtedly advancing on many fronts, not least in the church, which will not endure sound doctrine having itching ears. Many Christians have drunk deep draughts of New Age potions. For example, holistic health, hypnosis, yoga, inner healing, meditation, psychical research and awareness training, and many have imbibed new doctrines and heresies based on the humanistic and positive thinking of Teilhard de Chardin, Norman Vincent Peale and others, which provide the church with its emphasis on an earthly kingdom now, the social gospel and society reconstructed for Christianized with kingdom principles for the Lord's return. Restorationist leader Bryn Jones, writing in the beginning of 1991, promised his followers that, quote, By the power of his Spirit, we will bring all that is against God and man beneath Christ's authority. God's church will be the most influential body of people on earth in the final period of this age. Unquote. This is indeed a prophetic word, but it is fulfilled in Scripture only by the apostate church of the Book of Revelation. John Jimenez, National Chairman of Washington for Jesus in 1988, told that gathering of 500,000 people from 17 Christian denominations, quote, We believe that it is God's will that the righteous should reign on this earth, and we're seeing people preparing themselves to be lawyers, doctors, generals, admirals, presidents, and congressmen. The righteous shall rule, and the people will rejoice. Unquote. Problem is, no man is righteous, no, not one. And whoever defines righteousness, in this case, is the Pope, a man, the Roman Catholic Babylonian Satanic Church, and not the God of the Bible. One of the righteous he probably had in mind was Pat Robertson, who had run for the presidency of the United States in that year, 1988. Mr. Robertson heard of the prestigious Christian broadcasting head of the prestigious Christian Broadcasting Network and leader of the religious right in the United States wrote in his 1982 book, The Secret Kingdom, quote, "It is clear that God is saying, I gave man dominion over the earth, but he lost it. Now I desire mature sons and daughters who will in my name exercise dominion over the earth and will subdue Satan, the unruly and the rebellious. Take back my world from those who would use it and abuse it. Rule as I would rule." Unquote. No, God would never say that, because we are not to erect the kingdom of Christ here on earth for when our Master returns, because his kingdom is not from this earth. This statement of a very powerful and influential leader of American Christians is a chilling indication of how closely paralleled are the names and pronouncements of ecumenical Christianity and the New Age movement. It might very well have been said by a New Ager seeking the new order of dominion and peace and looking to little gods who will emerge in the age of Aquarius, acting for God in judgment and subduing Satan, including those who dissent. The Church does not have a mandate in the Bible to set up the kingdom for God, although restorationists with their apostles and prophets, reconstructionists, latter rain kingdom now, manifest Son of God's, dominionists, followers of world faith, positive confession and prosperity schools, and advocates of the social gospel, all have the Church restoring the kingdom of Christ for his coming. But before scourging, Jesus told Pilate, quote, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight?" Unquote. The Great Commission is the assignment of the Church to call believers out of the kingdom of this world, not to take back the kingdom of this world for Jesus Christ. Yes, he will establish his righteous kingdom as his second coming and destroy all earthly kingdoms that have been up to then. Daniel chapter 2, and the statue of the head of gold, the shoulder of brass, of silver, the belly of brass, and the legs of iron, and the stone not cut out with hands that smashes into the feet and destroys all these earthly kingdoms. We are not to put up Christ's righteousness here on this earth. Christ told us to be in the world, but not of the world. There is a big but subtle difference. Smokescreen, last part of chapter 8, which is called Multifaith and the New Age. Smokescreen. New Age observer and author Roy Livesey is convinced that much of what we see is an elaborately devised smokescreen for the deception fashioned by the Jesuit order and the Church of Rome. For example, Mr. Livesey sees Professor Quigley's influential book Tragedy and Hope, The Study of Global Conspiracy, as part of the subtle deception, pointing away from the Antichrist. Now, first and for all, the book Tragedy and Hope from Carol Quigley is 1363 or 1663 pages big. Guess how many times the word Jesuit appears in that book? Not 10 times, not 100 times, but one time. And he says here that it is part of a subtle deception pointing away from the Antichrist. And here the author inserts a footnote that was not in the German reading. Let us stop to ask the simple question, who is the Antichrist? The Antichrist, defined by Scripture, is he who denies the Father and the Son, as we can read in 1 John 2 chapter, verse 18. The line of popes has denied the Father and the Son by taking their place. The Pope of Rome has claimed throughout Christian history to represent Christ as Vicar of Christ and to be Holy Father, known today to countless millions of the faithful as Papa. And let me insert here another little comment of mine. I made with a few Christian brothers, among them Tom Fress at the time, for which I'm very grateful, an 11-part video series of characteristics of Antichrist. Read that. I mean, watch that series. And there will be no doubt whatsoever that the papacy is the Antichrist of the Bible. Mr. Livesey, who was converted out of the New Age movement, argues in his book Understanding the New Age that Quigley's conspiratorial view of history, which spawned so many others in its wake, explored every suspect avenue except that of his own Jesuit order, historically the most likely culprit. Another professor of history, Norman Cohn, writing about the myth of the Jewish world conspiracy, states in his book, Warrant for Genocide, that it can be traced back to a French Jesuit, Abbé Barouet, who appears to have instigated the myth on which the infamous Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion were based. For that, I refer you to my reading of chapter 2 or chapter 3 of my book reading Behind the Dictators. There I will, without any doubt, prove to you that exactly the French Jesuit Abbé Barouel was the one who wrote the so-called Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion, a Jesuit deception to blame again the Jews. The Pope is well placed to emerge as spiritual leader of the New Age movement as it set its sight, in parallel with the decade of evangelization toward the 2000 AD and the beginning of the Age of Aquarius, or the Age of the Spirit. Like the Vatican, the New Age has close links with powerful organizations such as the United Nations, UNESCO, the World Council of Churches, the Club of Rome, the Trilateral Commission, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Bilderberg Group, and the Freemasons. Other organizations and movements with a political agenda, such as the Conversationists and the many and various peace and disarmament groups, also act as a veil behind which one world government and one world religion are taking shape. You have to look behind the curtain. As suggested earlier in this book, Mary, the mother and virgin queen, has near universal appeal. She is already playing a major role in helping to bring together a one-world religion and is certainly attracting New Age devotees too. She is readily associated with Mother Earth, the creation from man's perspective, and pagan earth goddess Gaia. Her apparitions at Medjugorje since 1981 are supported by Benjamin Cream's Terror Center as a sign that Maitreya, the Christ, is in the world, according to New Age author Elizabeth Clare Prophet, writing about Mother Mary's New Age teaching and rosary. This finishes the reading of Chapter 8 of the book All Roads Lead to Rome, The Ecumenical Movement by Michael de Semlyen. There's, of course, a lot of study that you have to do next to reading this one book, reading other books, other things that will also confirm in their research everything that I've said here. The book, for example, from Dave Hunt, A Woman Rides the Beast, is one of the books that I can advise you to read on that subject. And I hope that you will do your own research and come to the same conclusions. And never forget, the first book that you have to read, the first book that you have to believe, the first book that you have to understand is the Holy Bible, the Word of God, who gave us that book as a manual how to best go through life. How to adhere to His word, to His law. And when we do that, and we accept the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, who shed His blood 2,000 years ago at the cross, so that we can stand blamelessly before our God, our Creator, again, after Jesus washed us white through His blood, then we will be given eternal life, and there's no other way but Christ. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody comes to the Father except by me, Jesus said. These words are maybe said 2,000 years ago, but they are valid throughout all eternity. And we only can solve our problems we have here on earth if we go through Christ, because we can't do nothing through ourselves, but everything is possible with Jesus Christ. So I hope you enjoyed this reading and also the other parts of this book, and I hope you will come back and listen and watch for the next part, chapter 9, which then is called Protestantism Under Siege, chapter 9 of All Roads Lead to Rome, from Michael de Semlyen. Up to here, Jogler 66 from Hour of the Truth. Thank you very much for listening and watching. God bless you, and until next time, bye bye.
We as Bible-believing Christians, we know that the hand that is behind ISIS, the hand that is behind Al-Qaeda, is the same hand that is behind the United States of America government, that is behind the European Union government, and that is behind all the armies in the world, and that is behind all these mercenary companies out in the world, like XE, or formerly called Blackwater, run by Knights of Malta, etc., etc. So this is something that you really have to understand. This is all just a theater. And the point is, where is this theater going to lead to? When you are a Bible-believing Christian, you know that in the end times, Jesus warned us in Matthew 24, there will be wars, wars, and rumors of wars. And we know that the Antichrist, by peace, will destroy many, and so on, and so on, and so on. I could start citing the whole Bible up and down right now with citations like this to tell you what it's all about. But I don't have to sing to the choir or preach to the choir. You, as Bible-believing Christians, already know that. So the only thing that I ask of you is don't be caught in their game. Because when you are and you play their game, you have to play by their rules. And their rules are not Christ's rules. So the only thing that I can advise you of is, okay, take that information in what happens about there, pray for the people that these victims are being taken good care of, and that they are just deceived people, that they maybe have a chance by going through this situation. Maybe they have a way to find to Christ in this way. Maybe they have a way to find to the real truth. I mean, these people are Muslims and coming from Muslim countries and coming to so-called, quote-unquote, Christian countries. Of course, the Roman Catholic Church is not Christian. Of course, the Protestant churches today don't preach any protest anymore. All right, I know that. But still, here and there, it is possible that a grain falls on the ground that can fall on fruitful ground, even with these refugees and the whole situation that is coming up. And that is the hope that we should have as Bible-believing Christians, and that is the prayer that we should use every day when we address our Lord, to pray for our enemies as we pray for our friends. Because Jesus said, love your enemies and love your neighbor.